we at Antique firmly believe that the future looks more promising. Sentiment has to change before a genuine, sustainable pickup can be witnessed, and I think it has changed for good. I would like to highlight one other observation here. Every economy in the world has followed the golden rule of development, from agriculture to manufacturing and manufacturing to services. India has been at its innovative best, jugaad, as we call it in the Indian term. We have magically skipped the manufacturing sector and leapfrogged into large services economy thanks to our ITO-BPO strength and high labor cost in the developed economies. We are now trying to figure out a way to fix this missing piece in this puzzle, and rightfully so. New government, led by visionary Prime Minister, and his various initiatives like Swachh Bharat, Make in India, has all the potential to escalate into a movement and, in fact, could be a revolution. Let's not forget, we have seen revolutions in the past in India, whether it was Quit India movement during the freedom struggle or Green Revolution in 1960s. Believe me, such initiatives may have to face initial challenges and skepticism, but I'm sure with focused and committed approach, it will serve the right foundation for sustainable and consistent economic growth. We at Antique are firm believers that the Make in India is the most appropriate slogan that we ever had. We always had a natural advantage demographically to be a manufacturing hub, thanks to the availability of labor, entrepreneur skills, but how somehow policies and their implementation, red tapism, corruption, probably prevented us from being one. Time is ripe. Time is now. And hence we thought it fit to have a distinguished panel to decode the Make in India theme and various challenges which we may face with regard to labor problems, land problems, financial problems, infrastructure issues, etc., for successful rollout of the same. To discuss this further, I would like to invite our panelists. I would like to also share that all the panelists, none of them need an introduction. But nevertheless, as a matter of protocol, I'll probably say a few lines about them. May I now first invite a moderator of the event, Mr. Raghav Bell, to please take the stage. Raghav began as a career as a management consultant with A.F. Ferguson & Company, followed by a stint with American Express Bank. He is one of the country's most admired media professionals. He was responsible for directing most of the work at TV18 and channels like CNBC, Awaaz and Colors. Recently, he has written a book, Superpower, and I think there is something else in offering as well soon. Raghav has over 22 years of experience in television and journalism. Raghav, I remember watching you and beginning my career in this industry in BBC India Business Week. Our next panelist is Dilip Bhai Shanghvi of Sun Pharma. Dilip Bhai is the founder and managing director of Sun Pharmaceuticals. Dilip Bhai generally doesn't like to be said anything about him, so I'm probably being too brave there. He started his career with a small capital of 10,000 rupees in 1982. Today, it is the largest drug maker and most valuable drug company. He is also credited with steering Sun Pharma to fifth place in the global generic drug market. He has been awarded Entrepreneur of the Year award as well. He also has been named in the list of Asia's top 10 wealthiest self-made billionaires. Friends, I would like to share with Dilip Bhai's permission one experience which I had with him way back in 1995 when the company went public. There was a time where we had a meeting with one of the senior fund managers, but due to some changes at the last minute, the meeting had to be rescheduled 2 hours later. Generally what we do, we go to Taj and Oberoi, have a cup of coffee, and then go for the meeting. Dilip Bhai said, look, Can I get a cabin in your room, in your office at Nariman Point and a glass of water? I wouldn't like to be disturbed. He had a thick volume of Pharma with him. He was not aware about this going to happen. And he just parked himself into the room and just did his reading for 2 hours. 4:45 came out for the 5 o'clock meeting. I was just thinking in hindsight now. Had I had the vision then of identifying which company will grow, I wouldn't have gone wrong in my call. But anyway, better late than never. Our next panelist, I would like to invite Mr. Ashwin by Dani. Ashwin by Dani, please. Ashwin by Dani is the Vice Chairman of Asian Paints, India's largest homegrown paints company. With sales growing 20% annually for the past 5 years, it has found a spot amongst Forbes, Asia's fabulous 50 companies, 3 years in a row. He started his career as a development chemist with BASF Detroit and joined Asian Paints in 1968 as a senior executive. He is currently the vice chairman and managing director of Asian Paints, the market leader in the Indian paint industry. He was instrumental in setting up joint venture between Asian Paints and PPG Industries of USA. Here again, when I was discussing with Ashwin by a few days back, the sense which I got about from him, the culture in which the organization works, is something which many of the Indian companies would like to imbibe in their company to grow in the manner in which Asian Paints have grown. Thank you, Ashwin bhai, to be with us. Next panelist, Mr. Rana Kapoor of Yes Bank. Sir, please, can you join us on the dais? A professional entrepreneur since 2003, is progressively establishing a high-quality, state-of-art private Indian bank with a vision of building the best quality bank of the world in India by 2020. Under his leadership, Yes Bank has steadily evolved as the professional bank of India, with exemplary business and financial outcomes as evidenced in his financial results since inception. He was recognized as the Entrepreneur of the Year at Asia Pacific Entrepreneur Award, Entrepreneur Banker of the Decade by Bombay Management Association, was ranked as the second most valuable Indian CEO of the Year by Business World Magazine. These are a few of the things which I could recollect, which I put up on the record, sir. Again, with Mr. Kapoor, I had a privilege to be with him during the IPO of Yes Bank. It was the first day of IPO opening in Hong Kong. When we ended the day, the issue was subscribed on the day one. At the evening when we were sitting, I was just asking him, sir, how do you feel? He says, well, at one end I'm happy. At the other end, I'm feeling the sense of responsibility which so many shareholders have put on me. Sir, you have delivered more than what they would have expected. Our next panelist, Mr. Tulsi, Tanti of Suzlon Group. Tulsi, bhai, please. An Indian MNC and a global leader in the wind energy. He is one of the world-renowned alternate energy expert and a visionary. He is passionate about the cause of renewable energy. Under his leadership, Suzlon has attained a leadership position as the fifth largest wind turbine manufacturer in the world. He has been honored with numerous awards, including Champion of the Earth by UN Environment Program, Hero of the Environment by Time Magazine, Entrepreneur of the Year by ENY, India Business Leader by CNBC TV18. I don't know, Tulsi bhai, if I missed a few of them. Thanks. Now for a good discussion, we are expecting one more panelist. Maybe he's not yet, he's on his way. But in the interest of time, Raghav, would request you to take it forward.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A very, very warm welcome to this marquee conference. Before getting into the discussion, I do want to congratulate our friends at Antique with whom I've personally also had a very long association, Kirti Bhai, Dharmesh Bhai. You know, relationships which are born in adversity are the ones which actually sustain the longest. Usually, I have not anchored any discussion for almost a decade. I've almost always politely declined, saying that there are many other younger colleagues who are so much better at this job, and I gave up doing that about 10 years ago. But there was no way I could say no to them, because when we were going through some very tough times in the 2008-2010 crisis, you know, and they were always there as friends, philosophers, and guides. So it's wonderful to be back here at this conference with them. I believe Mr. Sajjan Jindal is here, so I would welcome him to be on the panel. Like all the other panelists, he also doesn't need any elaborate introduction. Now to the theme of today's discussion, which is Build India, New India. And obviously, this is something that has been picked up from the slogan that the Prime Minister has given us of Make in India. I promise this will be the last personal reference I will make, but in 2010, when I had written my first book, Comparing India and China, the conclusion that one had made in 2010 was that there were two ways of looking at the India-China comparison. One was that China was four times our size, and that was the more popular way of looking at the comparison. But to me, the more fundamental comparison was that we in 2010 were where China was in 2003. So to me, the difference wasn't a fourfold economy. To me, the difference was a seven-year lag. And 7 years in the life of nations can be a blip. And I had at that point concluded that we were institutionally much more stronger in 2010 than China was in 2003. Therefore, in a real sense, the institutional lag was even less than 7 years because our institutions had evolved much better. Unfortunately, that hypothesis ran into a lot of rough weather, largely because of completely inexplicable policy paralysis that followed 2 or 3 years after I made that hypothesis in my book. But mercifully and delightfully, we now have the agenda back on track. We do have a Prime Minister who is being very bold in taking some decisions which seemed impossible some time back. So I do believe that we are back on track and that we can come back to that time lag hypothesis with China, that we have a time gap to cover and not really a four or a five-fold GDP size to cover. And nobody is better here than the panel that I have, because all of them run very successful businesses. They straddle manufacturing, infrastructure, they straddle technology, innovation, services. So really, the best of the Indian economy is here with me on this panel. And let's therefore dive right in. The format that I would suggest is if we begin with about 2 or 3 minutes of your assessment of where we are in this Build India, New India initiative, how much have we covered, whether you are seeing real changes on the ground, and what, more importantly, is needed to get that momentum going. So if you can make your opening remarks, please do try and confine yourself to 2 or 3 minutes, and then we'll launch right into a discussion. So let me begin with you, Mr. Tanti, on my left, and then we'll go across to Rana and then sort of shuffle across to the middle of the panel.
I think the industry's the opportunity in the current environment is growing very rapidly. The sentiment and confidence and credibility is increase of the India. So the global investment interest has increased a lot. The last Davos visit also, we found so many interest and excitement for the investment. People want to understand what are the opportunity and potentialities there. When we are talking about making India, and if we just focus on a renewable energy, I think government has set the very ambitious plan. By 2022, it's nearly 200 gigawatt capacity, 100 gigawatt solar and 100 gigawatt of wind, It's a really very ambitious target set by the government, and they are supporting all aspects to make that happen. But as you know, the India has lots of challenge and uncertainty. We have to fix up the certain constraints and barriers. It will unlock the lots of potentiality of the investment. Our prediction based on the current environment, $50 billion investment will flow in the next 5 years in a renewable energy field. So that is a good interest of the global investor, and domestic investors are there. It's not just we have found that the international investor is interested, but the domestic corporate house are also very much interested to invest in a renewable space. So that momentum has increased. And after the new policy for the captive manufacturing requirement, particularly for accelerated depreciation, it is changing the landscape in India further. Because we have found the so many manufacturing, particular SME companies, the biggest constraint and bottleneck for them, A, is the higher interest cost, and B, is the higher energy cost. If we really address, we can unlock the SME sectors, the manufacturing capacity in a larger scale basis. Right. So we are becoming catalyst to bringing the captive energy from the wind for them, and the accelerated depreciation giving benefit for the capital, which by that way they are hedging their power cost for the next 20 years. Right. And those textile cluster, auto industries, the food processing and cold storage, I think it is coming out forward, and that huge investment will flow in the manufacturing in India in next 5 years.
So Rana, to get you in here, while you make your opening remarks, do also focus a bit on the fact that while we have seen some amount of buoyancy perhaps sustaining through the consumer credit sector, when it comes to industrial and infrastructure credit, we are not seeing that pickup. So your assessment of why that is not happening, and when do you see the turnaround cycle there?
No, Raghav, I agree with Tulsi Bhai that first and foremost, the business confidence, I think the overall conviction in the economy, most of all driven by very effective communication, has at least improved the business dynamics, the business momentum in the country. But the fact of the matter is, a large-scale program like Make in India naturally has certain dependencies. And in my assessment, there are three, four things which need to be accelerated to get this program off to a successful start. We must recognize that Make in India in itself is 50 years after Japan conceived something like this, 30 years, after what China did very successfully. And since, Raghav, you did make a short comparison with China, India's manufacturing global value-added share is just about 1.8%. China today is at 35%. And then when you look at high-tech manufacturing, India is negligible, and China is about 24%. So we are way behind, and then we have to figure out what are those spaces where India, for its domestic market, because in my assessment, the opportunity is very large in the short, medium term in the domestic market, and then steadily as we build manufacturing brands, geographic appellations, specialization in certain product fields, then we can build global competitive advantage. So this is the gestationary program. It will take 5, 10, 15 years for it to achieve its objectives of exports. It's going to take a long time to create jobs. In my assessment, it will require brands. So there is a gestation to all of this. The fact of the matter is, and I will come to your question as well, that the ease of doing business, our overall ranking, without being too repetitive, 142 out of 189, labor market efficiency, 99 out of global 148. Now, these are things that need to change very dramatically, the approval process in itself. And I think there is a backlog. This new government has inherited legacy issues. Today, to kickstart the economy, to get industrial activity going, and here you have by far the most successful companies who are not being tormented with some of the legacies, but you'll find hundreds of projects, large, medium, small, which are stuck.
They need financial closure. They need to get off the ground. To me, the credit offtake, the industrial momentum, the change in gears in the economy will happen if existing projects successfully get off the ground. And to me, that confidence in Indian business is the need of the hour. I'm not concerned about the FDI. Prime Minister said very articulately, first develop India. So infrastructure has to come through naturally, because manufacturing on its own is not a standalone business. It needs public services, right? It needs the ability to create transportation and logistics in the country. So manufacturing has a lot of dependency. So in my judgment, we must take stock of our current challenges, de-choke the economy, and in my assessment, we are roughly about 8 months away. September 2015, I think if we are really focused in clearing the backlog of past projects, making sure the last mile financing falls in place and the projects get off the ground, to me, that is the starting point of the blue revolution. You've seen, I think Dharmesh spoke about the green revolution. We saw the white revolution in dairy. I think the blue revolution in manufacturing will happen when current businesses are successful.
Okay, that's a very interesting point you make, Rana, and I bring Mr. Jindal into this one, since you've got ongoing projects on the ground and obviously lots of plans for other projects as well. The critical point that Rana has made is that until we can de-choke the existing projects and get them going, and until that multiplier goes through the economy, some of these plans are likely to take longer than all of us perhaps have the patience for. What is your current experience with getting the existing projects off? And if they are not getting off, what is that one vital thing that needs to be done?
Yeah, I think what you're asking and what Rana said is very, very correct. So what this government has done in the last 8 months of its governance and then since they've come into power is to build the confidence of the investor community, whether it is the investor as in financial investor or investors like me who is investing in large projects. So this government has tried to really prop up the confidence level that we are with you, we want to support you, we want industry, we want manufacturing. And that is what this government over the last, whether it's the Prime Minister or his colleagues, they are giving this confidence back to the investor community. And that's, I think, the first very important step. Last, in the UPA too, where we suffered, was that there was no clarity of thought whether the government wanted projects to happen. One wing was saying, or one arm was saying, that we have to move forward, and the other one was saying, no, we have to go back. Case in point, you take the power sector, which is where coal is a very important ingredient for the power sector. Now, one arm of the government was going on issuing coal licenses or coal mining licenses, and the other was saying that there is no go. This cannot be there. You cannot do mining here. So first, government, when it's a one single body, they should first internally decide that, because investor is investing money. And then suddenly he comes to know that, well, I put up the project, but now my mine has become gone into no-go area. So with the same government giving, one arm is saying that, okay, this you can do the mining, another is saying you can't do. So now this government is putting all these things into order. And similarly, on the mineral, on the ordinance that they issued on the iron ore and the mining minerals, it's become very clear that now it will be through the auction route, that through transparent route that this mining will be done. So I think over the next 2 years, my belief is that all these large projects, which are mineral-based projects, will get sorted out over the next 2 years. And today I feel much more confident to invest money in this situation.
Is it essentially, what I understand from what you've just said, essentially a raw material choke, not a financial choke?
So there are many chokes. It's raw material is one of the major choke which we faced over the last 4-5 years, and so that's one of the major ones. But there is land issues. If you look at land issues now, in the previous government, they have literally made acquiring land impossible for the private projects. Now eventually, if we have to get to 25% of our manufacturing, which is the goal, which is the target Prime Minister has set up, Without land, you cannot build projects. And getting land today is for large projects, you need large tract of land. It's becoming more and more impossible.
But just on this point, sorry for interrupting, because this is a very critical point and therefore no point coming back to it. The ordinance still hasn't made changes for the manufacturing sector. It's made it for infrastructure and defense, but not for manufacturing.
Not yet for manufacturing.
So how does it de-choke you?
So it's actually very difficult, because I had a lot of discussion with various people in the government, and they say that the previous government has made it so difficult, politically so difficult to fix it, the land issues. So they have fixed it for the public projects, but for private projects it's still some time before they can do it.
Mr. Dani, picking it up for you now, you of course interface directly with the consumer. And therefore you have the advantage of looking at the full spectrum from the side of making it, from the side of land acquisition, and all the way down to consumer demand, final consumer demand. What is your assessment? How much of a de-choke has happened? How much of a momentum you are seeing on the ground, and how much more needs to be done, and more importantly, what needs to be done?
It's very clear that on the ground, consumer demand has still not picked up. And I think the results of the last quarter from the FMCG industry, the signals are very clear that on the ground, demand has yet to pick up. And until I think the demand really picks up, I think the consumer industry is still not feeling the positive vibes that we see in the environment. Now, until and unless I think lot of positive indications are given on the buying power of the people, and I think the buying power is not really going to improve until and unless I think we see consumer demand.
So what could be holding it back? Because as I said, you interface directly with the consumer. You interface with the consumer on a product which, you know, it gets into their homes and then something that they can't do without, paint. What is holding the consumer back?
Well, I think there is a huge problem with respect to, I think, availability of jobs. And until and unless I think we handle that particular issue fundamentally, I don't think we are really going to see spot in demand. And I think availability of jobs, the employment opportunities is not going to improve until and unless I think we handle the issue of skill development. And I think the previous Prime Minister had initiated a lot of work, but I think there is a lot of ground to be covered. I think it is a fact that India will have to, I think, provide a large number of construction workers, because construction provides one of the largest opportunity for providing jobs.
Right.
And today, if you really see, there are not enough number of skilled masons, enough number of skilled construction workers, enough number of carpenters, enough number of electricians available in the country. And I think the construction industry is not really going to pick up until and unless I think housing finance is available at attractive rate of interest. And so it has to start right from I think availability of housing finance, because we know that there are enough residential premises available in some of the metros, but I think those properties are not getting sold because the interest rate that what people have to provide. So I think
I was waiting when that interest rate factor would come in, because you know, a lot of constraints have been mentioned, but interest rate has come up about 25 minutes into the discussion.
So It is a fact that I think we have to handle the issue of availability of jobs, and today I think the kind of youth that is coming out from the colleges, if they don't get very attractive job opportunities, right, I don't think there is going to be...
So it really comes down to a shifting of the growth plane to a much higher growth plane, bringing down costs in the economy, including interest rate costs. Mr. Shanghvi, you are right there in the middle. You've had a splendid track record over the last few years. You've acquired businesses, you've built businesses, you've acquired them overseas, you've acquired them in India. So you would be in a very unique position, plus your businesses are not just straight businesses, they're also technology, knowledge-intensive, innovation-driven businesses. So in your assessment, what point are we at before these gears are shifted, gears of greater job creation, greater demand in the economy, are you going to continue to be a very diversified business across continents, or do you think the opportunity now more is in India?
I mean, if I look at pharma business as such, then we are already a supplier of large percentage of pharmaceutical products to the world. So this is one area in which I think Indian products are sold globally. In the US, almost 40% of generic products are supplied by Indian pharma companies. So, but we have much bigger potential to do much more than what we have done till now. Some of the issues which Ashwin Bhai talked about of, let's say, skill development. So, and our business is very knowledge intensive, very skill and innovation driven. So, and we see that availability of graduates from college who are employable is limited. So typically most of the people that we hire, they go through an extensive training program. So I think the important focus before we can become a supplier of products globally is to look at education, create capacity in our education system to generate employable youth. So on one side you have a huge challenge of, as Ashwin Bhai says, that enough job for people. On another side you have industry problem of not getting enough people that of the skill that they require. So we have to find a way to bridge this because manufacturing, unlike services, will require specific skills and capability for us to succeed and to be able to compete globally. The other issue is the issue of innovation for our business. Philosophically, as a country, we've never given premium for original thinking. So, and it's easier to copy, it's safer to copy because you have less risk of failure. So what
do you expect the government to come up with which can address this this philosophical deficit if one would put it that way?
So I think there are already initiatives for creating, so the initiative to work with the industry to develop specific skill sets, to create a hub in each part of the pharma industry is specific in some region. So in those regions, create skill development centers. So
it's innovation would be a package of skills, risk capital, ability to think on a scale or at which ordinarily support would not be available. So that's a bigger issue that I think we'll come back to in a short while with the panel. But one final question on the... are you beginning to see a pickup in demand across the sectors that you deal with? Because your product is a different product. It's not something you consume for fun.
No, I believe that there is a correlation between economic growth and our growth. Generally, pharma business grows by 3-4% faster than the industry growth. But our overall per capita drug consumption is very, very low compared to, let's say, equally developed countries globally.
And does that have to, again, do with lower purchasing power, as Mr. Dani spoke about?
Lower purchasing power, lower number of doctors to treat.
Right.
Excess. So large number
so,
of issues.
So a lot of this debottlenecking has to happen before.
Will need
before
to be done.
I'm also tempted because in the audience we have Mr. Gautam Adani with us, and I would like to reach out to him. I think he's busy with. No, we'd love to reach out to and get your assessment, sir, since you a little bit on the infrastructure sector. Okay. So at whatever stage you want to come in, be good to hear on the power and infrastructure sector. Because that is the critical sector.
The last 3 to 4 years, power sector was struggling on the fuel availability point of view. And with that, most of the project which has come up on operations and then regulatory issue of compensatory tariff, and the government could not basically find out the solution because it was a concluded contract between the state utilities and the private power utilities. And center has not intervened basically or not tried to intervene basically between the contracts. That lead to lots of losses which private generating company has absorbed. Now things are basically moving in a right manners where fuel availability issue on these coal allocations also will going to be sorted out. And I think the next 3 to 4 months, the allocations of these auctions of the coal block should be over. And the fuel availability points of view, in next 2 to 3 years, the India will be in a comfortable levels. And with that, power sector should again come up. And second, basically what Mr. Tanti is talking about, government of India is right now focusing lots on renewable energy point of view. And that is a very good opportunity is throwing from Indian power sector's point of view.
Just one follow-up question. Fuel availability was, of course, one of the biggest bottlenecks. But the other bottleneck was the availability of long-term financing, either by way of equity or by way of debt for projects which obviously had cost overruns because they had stalled because of fuel availability and other issues. Has that problem been sorted out?
See, this government in last budget also, they have announced 5x25 financing on the debt side. That is a very good initiative this government has taken, because all this project and this contract is 25 years, and where repayment earlier was used to be a 10 years, where hardly promoter have any surplus money for in any expansion, in spite of basically they are making 16-20% returns. So this 5x25 initiative also will unlock a lot of cash surplus in the investable basically situation where the developer will have the money available for their expansions.
So let me bring, thank you, Mr. Anand. Let me bring Rana in here, because since we are talking about financing. There is some feeling that not enough has yet been done to get long-term financing, long-term capital, long-term bond markets going. Do you think that is something that is now going to occupy center stage? And if yes, what is that one or two critical things that need to be done to develop that market? The mic's in front of you, Rana.
Raghav, this question becomes very relevant because, you know, if we have to invest in long-term assets, particularly in infrastructure, we have to create a long-term bond market. So while the 5x25 scheme is a good start, but it will be done probably in modules of 5 to 10 years in the absence of a domestic market, which is still, you know, some time away. I think we need to see what are the pension fund, provident fund, and gratuity fund related measures that need to be taken. You know, we have a system where there is a significant surplus which is sitting with the Indian saving system, particularly provident funds, and they invest only in AAA paper.
And AAA to me is very scarce because most of that is government. So tax benefits that need to be accorded to shift the investment pattern of some of these funds to permit them to invest in infrastructure bonds, which could be structured obligations, good cash flow capture. So I think the investment design of some of our savings institutions, that in itself needs to be revisited. Naturally, the opportunity to attract pension funds from overseas. Just 2 days ago, there was a very large delegation that interacted with the government. Pension funds from Singapore, from Canada, from Australia are looking at the Indian market because we're just about seeing positive real interest rates surfacing in the Indian market. Because please remember, we've been living with negative rates for a long time. So I think if we package Indian opportunities well, the risk systems in our country get a little bit more structured.
Right.
I have every reason to believe that global savings, which are fairly benign, plenty of resources available, I think with good roadshows, good opportunities, we should be able to attract long-term debt capital as well.
So long-term debt capital is clearly one of the big ideas that the government should come up with. Mr. Jindal, when we get an assessment from a panel like this, the assessment always is major movement forward in sentiment, major movement forward in looking upon industry now as partners and not as adversaries. But when it comes to actual action on the ground, there seems to be a lot more that needs to be done. So I would like now my panelists to address that. What are the one or two out of the box, not standard, out of the box things that you would need done for your industry to really make a quantum difference? So let's begin with what you believe should be done, which may be politically difficult. So don't please give the benefit of the doubt to the government. If it's politically difficult, it's the government's job to get it done. But what should be done?
So if I was to talk about the steel industry, which is my main business.
Right.
Today, the world steel is a product which can flow in and out of the country from various parts of the world. So it's a global commodity. What is today creating problems for Indian steel industry is that two things. One is the raw materials, which government is trying to fix. They have come out with a new ordinance, and so
yeah, so their action has happened.
Action has happened.
Yes.
On the other side, we don't have very quick redressal system on dumping. So when, for example, let's take an example of Russia and Ukraine, where their currencies have crashed by nearly 100%. They've become double of what it used to be. And Russia, demand within Russia and Ukraine has collapsed. So they are now dumping steel into India. So our government does not have a very quick mechanism, mm-hmm. or even the industry is not prepared to apply to the government to take a very quick action on this redressal to bring in countervailing duties or bringing in anti-dumping or safeguard duties. So now the industry is working together to create this concept, and thereby we are going to we are already in discussion with the government. But whether they can act very quickly on that, that will depend a lot how this industry will.
So that's an important point. You are saying you think a much greater industry government coordination on moving on international forums when Indian industry gets unfairly exposed.
Not only international forum, but even on Indian, right. To protect your own industry. For example, Europe, 77 countries in the world, within 1 week of the Russian ruble crash, put in the anti-dumping or safeguard duties.
Right.
Protected their own countries. But India has failed to do that till now.
One final question on this particular issue. Did you try to reach out to the government?
We did. We have had
what
number
was the
of
response?
Meetings. There is a very positive response, but they are saying that give us the data.
Okay.
So we are now trying to create the data. It's not very easy to get the data that what is the injury, what is the kind of surge in imports. So all these things, and it takes even to industry to come together to.
But if 77 countries were able to compile that data, why couldn't we just pick it up from their websites?
So it's not so.
What I really
yeah,
mean
but,
is why couldn't we do
that? That is exactly what now the industry is doing, and we are working on that.
Mr. Shanghvi, out of the box, one or two ideas that will make a quantum difference. Not general things like cut in interest rate, but specific to your major industry.
I think a lot of bureaucratic restrictions in research.
Like?
So, for doing animal experiments, for import of large animals, for let's say doing phase one, phase two studies, human studies, simple issues is that let's say when you're doing clinical trial for a cancer drug, let's say prognosis of patient is patient will die within say some virulent cancer in 3, 4, 5 months. So there would be some deaths in the clinical trial. Possibly because of the drug, the number of deaths may be lower than what it would have been otherwise if they were not treated. But the regulatory process that is now in place for any company to do clinical trial in India and the kind of what you call onerous responsibility on the sponsor for any kind of potential. Say like normally in India you can't do a placebo control study. Now globally you can do placebo control study. So large number of unrealistic restrictions prevent the industry to be able to invest in research. So like if I look at Sun Pharma, then many, many studies that we do outside of India, we could have done them within the country and we could have done it much faster. So I think a much more pragmatic policy. And the second would be financing and a much more realistic, say like globally in Canada, people in, say whatever is the investment in R&D, you get tax breaks. So you pay, government returns 80% of what you invest by giving you a break in your tax payment. So that those countries are much more attractive for doing research. So these are two important issues that if they happen, it will significantly help the industry.
So that's interesting. We've had three leaders from three different industries. And when I asked them about what would be the out-of-box thing that the government should do from banking and finance, from steel and from pharmaceuticals, it comes down to still excessive regulation. There is excessive regulation or lack of a quick response from the government, as in the case of the anti-dumping duties. So this is interesting. I will now go to the consumer industry and see what are the couple of big ideas, because I'll come last to the renewable energy where the government is being very proactive. So I think Mr. Tanti would probably have the best things to say there. But the consumer industry.
See, talking about out-of-box solutions, one or two ideas I would like to share with you for spurting demand within the country. Since we operate for more than now 15, 20 years on all India basis, I can say that relatively you see there is a good demand for expensive products in the state of Kerala. And why? Because they have a huge number of people operating in various parts of the country, various parts of the world. Now, you see any local newspaper in Middle East, you see local newspaper even in Singapore, and also even some of the East European countries, they say very clearly in the ad that if it is City and Guild, certified electrician, plumber, carpenter, they get almost 2 to 3 times the salary than all these ITI trained technicians from India. Now, because of I think the kind of population that we have, if we can start these kinds of courses which are widely recognized throughout the world, I think there would be huge employment opportunities for our people outside of India, because it is a fact that we can't provide enough employment to people to feed only our domestic demand, and we have to create the kind of people so that they can operate at the global level.
So this is a point that obviously is coming through very strongly from your end about the need for higher, more productive skills, so that leads to higher wages and higher incomes, and therefore that leads back into higher demand for housing and basic products. How should the government do it? Should we open up these sectors to foreign investment, foreign institutions to come in and aggressively invest? What should be done?
Well, as I said, that plumber trained by ITI, because if you see the curriculum of our ITI, they have not undergone any further improvement, further changes in so many years to come. And government did come with this, if any of the industrial companies or any of the Indian companies adopt some of these ITIs, they did give some incentives. But I think that is not enough. That has to be incentivized much more. And this is one out-of-the-box solution, what I can suggest. Second thing, what Mr. Shanghvi said very clearly, for some of these clinical tests, Indian pharma companies are going out of India. And we have enough facilities for this clinical testing of pharma products. And they have to change certain laws for this. And it took a very, very long time. And it is, I think, a matter of shame for us that we have those facilities here. And we could have provided an employment for this clinical testing to our Indian trained graduates. But I think we did not act in time. So India has to be an R&D hub of the world. Just as what has happened in ITI,
IT information technology.
In IT industry, I think it has to come even as a R&D hub of the world, and we can really start attracting lot of. Now I'll just give you an example. Probably the second largest paint company in USA. They have set up a huge R&D laboratory now in Pune. They don't sell a single rupee worth product in India. But entire R&D activities of that paint company, what it does in USA, they carry out R&D activities in Pune. Now how many people are aware of it? And I'm sure that if it is applicable to the coating industry, it should be applicable to a lot of other chemical industries.
So even in pharmaceutical, that's a huge issue. I mean, if we are able to...
So we can provide employment. We have to create good employment opportunities for our well-trained graduates.
Okay, so I think two or three issues are really coming through over and over again. One is much better regulatory framework, much more supportive regulatory framework, much more timely government intervention to a stitch in nine, literally saving time. And of course, a far more modernized education system on a much bigger scale. If I could summarize, these are the three or four line items which have come as the big things that the government should really put all its energy behind. And of course, longer term financing. These three or four have emerged. Let me now turn to Mr. Tanti, whose industry, as I said, is in a sweet spot, because the government is probably being more ambitious about that industry than private industry itself. The government has put much higher targets. Targets is one thing. Do you believe commensurate action is also happening from the government to promote the achievement of these targets?
I think some of the initiatives already taken, particular because say it's a regulatory industries, power sector, and within that renewable. The two, three policy initiatives already government has taken, which has accelerated the investment into the industries. So that is moving in the right. But still, when we see the size of the target versus the momentum is not good enough. So we have to...
So what would need to be done? What are the two big ideas that you would give to the Prime Minister? Because this is one area where he keeps on saying that his ambition is much more than what India can dream of in renewable energy. So what would you say to him? Sir, please do these two things and we'll get your ambition going.
I think 200 gigawatt targets, and even country's future requirement, 30% energy, we have a home resources, wind and solar, it's a huge potentiality is there. We have a technology in-house within the country. We don't require dependency on technology. So that competency, we are exporting technology to develop economy also. I think the more focus area is required, the financeable PPA, number one, the priority, and security of the payment. Because that is the key bottleneck of the unlock the size of the market. Today, India is doing 2,000 megawatt.
Payment from consumers and electricity companies. Is that... Yes, so that is a, for the power sector, that is one big reform across the power sector.
Yeah, but here it is a, nine states are mostly doing a renewable development. Instead of that, centralize the PPA mechanisms for the renewable specifically. And if we develop and give the clarity of the funding will be available of the timely payment. So the banking sector should come forward to invest in these types of the projects as a debt instrument, because that is the biggest bottleneck in the thing. Equity availability is not a concern. Domestic and global equity is flowing in this sector. But the biggest concern is the availability. Even 100 megawatt project, I have to go 4 banks and to collect the money, it takes 6 months. So this is the biggest barrier of the time concern is there. And their concern is the power sector is not performing very well. So they don't want to lend much more. But if you bring that confidence, yes, this is the secured PPA, long-term PPA. Not only that, the cash flow will be available on time. So if you can address that centrally, rather than going each state-wise utility. So that is the number one areas corrections are extremely important is there. The second, when we are talking about the skill development, I think we should not expect too much from the government. They cannot able to change and transformation of the education system and other things. Most of the part of the world, we have seen we are working in Netherlands, Denmark and Germany. We are working very closely with the universities and the colleges for the technology development and for the skill development. So industries has to come forward to connect with the institutes, because every city has a very nice university and institutes are there. If you connect with them and develop the skill, it's the industry space rather than general education.
But there is also a cultural issue in India, isn't it?
Yeah, but we have
to make the apprentice a much more honorable title, because everyone wants a bachelor's of honors graduate.
But actually that culture we have to change, and we have to go application-based education.
Right.
Okay, suppose in one particular city is a textile-based city. The education system is support for the textile industries.
Right.
So industries and university work together and make that happen. Okay, how I can provide the talent on that front. So that can solve our talent. Because one side is a huge job creation opportunities, the other side there is no jobs are available. So both is a huge disconnect is there.
Right.
And that's industries and university can work together and make that happen.
So I think this would be a good time to turn to our audience. You've heard some of the most accomplished people in India's corporate sector as well as India's economy. You've heard what they have to say about the kind of changes they are witnessing on the ground ever since the new government has taken reins. It would be good for you to address questions that you have in your mind. So let's give about 15 to 20 minutes to this question and answer session from the audience. So please raise your hand who would like to ask a question. Do identify yourself very briefly. Try to keep it as a short question and not a long declamatory comment. So please go right ahead with your questions. Who would like to go first? So do we have any question coming in from the audience? Or everyone has been so convincing that you don't have any engagement on any thought that has been expressed on the panel? Come on, I'm sure there are questions. Someone has to break the logjam. Yes, right there, sir. So would you take the mic across to him, please, at the table there? Right here. Do we have a mic? Yes, right here. Please do identify yourself, short introduction and your question.
Good morning. I'm Adesh Gupta, CEO, Liberty Group. My question is to the panelists. While we see that the planning part is lying with the central, whereas the execution happens in states, so we always see that, you know, there are a lot of talk and buzz about these changes are being made at the policy level. But at the end of the day, the execution of any kind of project is happening with the state. Let's say GST, it is, you know, the states which are responsible where the GST has to come. Similarly, the large-scale projects or any kind of big-ticket changes we need, whether it's skill development, whether it is ITI, whether it is, you know, curriculum, whatsoever it is, the center can only make policies. So what is the preparedness of the states where, you know, we have the center and the opposition states? So I would like to ask the panelists, what is the preparedness of the states? Because at the end of the day, in my opinion, it is the state where all the central policies have to be executed and where we see the obstacles?
Actually, that's a very interesting and a very vital question. Are we, in your experiences, are you seeing that there is increasing coordination between the states and the center, or there continues to be a discord? Who would like to pick this question up? Rana?
Yeah, Raghav, let me take a shot at this. In my assessment, this overall game plan of the new government to create more and more cooperative federalism and maybe dovetail with competitive federalism, because this is what is resonating last 30 odd days or so, to me it's a good message. But how do you cascade that into outcomes? Take an example like labor, right? There are, I think, 44 central laws, but there are over 160 state laws, you know, which need to be sorted out, and maybe sorted out at a high level at the center, because the center can give overall direction, they can give labor guidelines. So guidelines as far as industrial standards are concerned, employment standards are concerned, wages, and maybe even social security. But end of the day, the proof of the pudding is in terms of the conversion at the state level. Example, let's take a positive example, Rajasthan. See, Rajasthan has taken excellent measures in the last 4-5 months to enact labor legislation, which has been, in a way, a flag bearer of what other states can imitate in course of time. So competitive federalism, to me, is a very important aspect for our states to reform, as long as the center is sending, you know, very clear messages in terms of what they want achieved. And this is a movement which needs to naturally pick up momentum. And as you can see, there are certain states which are languishing, and many states in the country which are actually demonstrating double-digit state GDP. So governance at the state level, e-business, e-governance at the state level, these are initiatives which I believe are being left largely to the states.
Okay.
And so governance at the state is very important.
Yes, it would be good to get your experience as well. You operate in several states.
I think it's a very, very interesting question on state-center relationship and how states can, what decisions should happen at the state level and what should come from the center. One out of the box thinking, well, I was thinking, what are those things which can propel the manufacturing sector in India? Could be some sort of an incentive which various and competitive environment which the central government should create amongst the states, that which state has increased the manufacturing percentage over the last 1 year or 6 months or 2 years, and what initiatives each state is taking, and that should be sort of publicized, and that should be recognized, incentivized. If that kind of thing within the government can be done, for example, since the change in government in Maharashtra, the new Chief Minister, I happen to have a number of meetings with him, and also Chandrababu Naidu in Andhra Pradesh. Now, both of them are extremely keen and are trying to ape the Narendra Modi model of Gujarat. And they are saying that if they can do it in Gujarat, why can't we do it in Maharashtra? And he's saying, why can't I do it in new Andhra Pradesh? So I think this kind of a competitive and positive environment got to be created, and something central government should do to create this sort of environment where state and more power should be given to the states, and center should be more on the policy framework side and not on the actual action side.
Okay, so you're saying that if a healthy competitive federalism is structure is created, that should take care of the problem. No other anomaly in the system. Anyone else would, Mr. Shanghvi, would you like to share your thought on this, since you would also have plants across various states?
So in pharma sector, I think we see that different states have different level of evolution in terms of managing the pharma business. And because of that, or maybe the other way around, is that pharma sector is predominantly successful in limited number of states. So Eastern India, you don't see a large number of successful pharma companies. Whereas if you see people working in our companies, then we would have many people from Eastern India migrating and coming and working. So I think the issue of having a consistent policy and execution framework to ensure consistency with the policy of the country is a very important criteria. And especially for an industry like ours, where quality is important, any complaint on quality internationally does not only affect that company, but also affects the whole industry. So I think it's necessary for a much more well-defined, clearly executed framework of execution, which will ensure consistency. So like things like, let's say, auto safety. So there is an India standard, and that needs to be implemented across all the states. So I think, at least in our industry, a much more consistent standard which is implemented across all states will facilitate industry growth.
Any other question from, yes, there's a question, a gentleman there who's raising his hand. Yes, would you take the mic across to him, please? Yes, Dev. Yeah. Yeah, so while the mic is going across, please do identify yourself and short question.
Thank you. My name is G.S. Ganesh from Inga. My question is to Mr. Ashwin Dani. A very important point was made about the consumerism in paints and absence of enough expenditure. Sir, do you think we have lived in a static world where all home loans, and maybe Mr. Kapoor can add it, home loans have been made more like a routine structure where every year they will add a percentage here and there to satisfy the home borrowers? Is it time for us to look at a completely a new structure to give incentivize the people who want to borrow money not only to buy houses, but go for a very rampant modernization of flats? Today we are constrained by a lot of age-old structures which have been posed.
Mr. Dani, and then Rana after that.
Well, as far as I know, even for modernization of your existing house, today's housing loan companies do advance money for that particular purpose. But the most important thing, I think, is the interest cost and the way the cost of the houses has really gone up in metropolitan regions. And until and unless I think housing loan is offered at a more attractive rate of interest, I do not see any bigger spurt in demand for housing loans. I think that is very important. Maybe Mr. Rana can add something more, but I would like to talk something what was just talked about. What is the difference in some of the policies followed by the central government and the state government?
Right.
And I think one classical example I know, which is affecting industries across the various states, is the e-governance. I know one of the IT secretary, when he was his job was changed to member secretary planning commission from IT secretary, and he brought lot of land records to be brought under e-governance, and I can tell you there is a substantial difference in terms of maintaining land records on e-governance. There is a substantial difference from one state to another, and I think there is a lot of scope for harmonizing what the central government under IT secretary prescribed. And I think if the land records are really brought under IT e-governance, it can really bring a lot of ease in terms of buying of land. And this is one of the biggest problem, as it was stated earlier, that all industries, when they want to set up new industries, they just don't get land. and land records are in a totally disarray. And I think that requires a lot of, coordinated effort between the center and the states.
Yeah, that's actually a big idea as well, just getting land records computerized.
Well, I think this question becomes very relevant in terms of, you know, housing itself, because if you see the new government has done a couple of fairly remarkable things when it comes to affordable housing. The policy of getting to 70 million homes by 2022, affordable homes, has been given priority sector lending classification. And number two, banks have been permitted to raise infrastructure bonds, long-term bonds, so that they can raise capital at much lower rates. The fact of the matter is that this has not yet been transmitted. So at least I believe that, give or take another 2 or 3 months, we should see a significant reduction in financing costs for housing loans. To me, that's a very important booster, nationally, for buying more homes, and two, also for restoring the momentum in the economy for reasons that were specified earlier by the panel. Construction starts, you know, EPC companies, a lot of those companies which are choked. Secondly, housing finance product development in India has not seen any uniqueness. So whether you have loans against property, long-term acquisition of property loans, sometimes loans to paint the town red, you know, those sorts of loans, are there, but we are not seeing enough mortgage-backed security development like Fannie Mae in the U.S. So we need a very good mortgage guarantee corporation to be set up, dematting of, you know, title deeds, naturally proper land and ownership records with the registrar. So a lot of product development is required around this sector to make financing far more attractive.
How about classifying housing industry as an infrastructure industry? That could also give a good boost.
So I think
in terms of lowering the interest cost.
No, Ashwin, I fully agree with you that the fact that it's been declared as PSL priority sector and infrastructure bonds have been permitted, the next logical step is housing itself with a certain threshold should be given infrastructure status. For that matter, education infrastructure, in my opinion, healthcare, R&D infrastructure, even hospitality and tourism, because, you know, our focus is largely on manufacturing. But the early wins in the economy, in my judgment, are going to come across in the services sector as well. And we should not neglect the scope of tourism and the job creation opportunity around tourism. So infrastructure in sunrise sectors, in my judgment, should be given high priority by the new government.
So let's have one final question from, now we have four hands up. So let's try and quickly get all these questions done. You already had a question, sir. Unless you want to ask a very quick follow-up or another question. Yes.
No, this is to Mr. Dilip Shanghvi.
Okay.
Sir, it is always felt that what differentiates an Indian pharma to a multinational pharma is the research. About 10 years back, we did see a private equity fund joining an Indian company to fund their research cause. Do you see more of such initiatives coming from Indian side?
I believe that in next 15, 20 years, we would have a very vibrant innovation-based pharma business out of India. But it's a process of time. It will take time. What we need is a few successes. So like we ourselves run a company called Sun Pharma Advanced Research Company, which focuses on innovative product development for global markets. What I think is required is a few successes of successful launches out of India in global markets will create a significant momentum going forward.
Some more question? There were three hands and then...
Hi, this is Navneet from SBI Fund. So I heard about two or three things. One is the severe descent in the governance. Of course, there is a ray of hope now. If I look at the overreach of the judiciary, because they believe that executive legislature has failed along with the business. If you look at the stress in the banking sector, which cannot alone be attributed to the slowdown in the economy and the policy paralysis, if you put all these things together and our inability to convince, I mean, the government is finding it tough to carry out the reforms that all of these people are saying in terms of the land or labor and why. Why? Because the society maybe somehow has not got convinced about it. What does that corporate sector do to ensure that the society builds that confidence and all these issues, governance, the stress in the banking and all? I think there's a lot of probably responsibility in the corporate sector as well, whatever few things have been done. What can corporate sector do that over the next couple of years, what Modi says that development becomes a movement like the independence, what can we do to ensure that we move on that path?
Okay, yes, Mr. Tanti, quickly.
I think corporate sector has a huge responsibility. Today, if we see the 400 million population in India don't have an excess of energy. We are sitting in a nice air-conditioned room, but they don't have an excess of energy. So what we are really doing is building the projects in the extreme rural part of our country, in a countryside, where the grid infrastructure is not there. They are very well prepared to pay the energy price. But the green infrastructure is not reached up to that extreme level because of they don't have access of energy. There is so many villages are there. We have built so many projects in more than 9 states on those rural part of the countries. And we have bring the energy to the main city, but same time, because of that energy production on that rural part, they are getting access of energy. Not only that, lots of SME industries are moving on that segments. Because now excess of energies are there. If you see the earlier days, the population was moving towards the river. Now the population is moving to the near to the energy sectors. So the energy is available in the rural part. They are putting their manufacturing SME companies are there because now they have a consistent power and energies are available is there. And same areas we are doing the social economic developments. So we are providing a lot of education supports, a lot of job creations on that. You will be surprised in our wind farms. There is no qualified engineers are working because they are not interested to work on the sites. Right? So we are training those village people. They have not educated even. But if you go and ask them, they talk on a technical language and they are working for day and night and managing and operating those assets. I think this is the requirement. So in the last 20 years, out of 400 million population, 50 million population we have given the access of energy. And that is the responsibility corporates are building. If you ask me honestly, the country is built by the corporates only. And that is the way all the developments are happening. So it is a cross responsibility, whether it is a private sector or public sector, both has to work to build the proper society.
Rana, you want to add there?
In my opinion, in the short, medium term, because, you know, we are addressing what needs to get the economy, you know, accelerated. I think the corporate sector has to do further introspection in terms of deleveraging. In my judgment, other than some very successful companies like Asian Paints and Sun Pharma and JSW Group, there are many, many corporates. I think almost 80-90% of the corporates are very highly leveraged in our country. Whether it's at the operating company level, at the holding company level, and more often than not, even at the promoter investment company level. So if you really want to bring laser focus in your businesses, rationalize your businesses, and add more shareholder, stakeholder value, deleveraging the economy is very important. And naturally, any improvement in leverage will help valuation and will also help a very troubled public sector banking system, which naturally reflects more or less the mirror image of the corporate sector. Please remember, it's two sides of the same coin. So I think this is a very, very important subject, at least for the next 12 to 18 months. And I think the second point, which is somewhat related and has not been discussed up to now, is the role of micro, small, medium enterprises. You know, we take them for granted, but if you see the data points on SMEs, they're roughly about 37.5% of industrial production. They are about almost 40% of exports. They constitute about 4.5 crore units across the country and employ approximately 8.5 crore people. So I think it is our responsibility, you know, as we talk, to really see how we can re-engineer micro SMEs, because they need credit at lower cost, refinance to make them more competitive at international LIBOR related costs. We spoke about clusterization of skill development, but naturally the skill development has to cater to local businesses, which must be geographically driven. So there is a lot of emphasis that I think we need to give in the role of SMEs going forward.
I'll take one last question, and yes, gentleman there. Can you move the mic to him, please? Yes.
Thanks, Raghav. This is Nikunj Doshi from Bay Capital. For most of the infrastructure projects in the past, we have seen a lot of activism by NGOs, and there's a lot of judicial activism also. So what has been the experience, and are you seeing any change with the new government coming in?
So that's a very interesting question. Mr. Jindal, would you take that NGO activism and judicial activism one?
So it's an interesting question. It's very relevant because in the past government, in the UPA too, the NGO activism had really increased. I mean, it starts with NGO, then media picks up. From media, the judiciary became super active, and large projects were stalled, and the project after project got affected. This government has taken some initiative. They have talked a little tough on the NGOs, especially the NGOs which are funded from overseas funding. So those NGOs have been sort of reined in, may not be fully, but there is a balance which is being brought in, because we must not forget that NGO not necessarily is very straightforward or unbiased. There are a lot of issues, a lot of things where NGOs are also politicized, or there are competitors who are funding these NGOs, and therefore the projects, large projects, have suffered in India. And we all know which are those very large projects which have suffered. So I think this government is making the right noise and is trying to rein in this. And this is very important for large projects to happen in our country.
And judicial activism, do you believe that if you have a more proactive government, then that administrative vacuum goes away and therefore the incentive or even the compulsion for the judiciary to step in goes away? Would that be a fair statement? Would everybody agree with it? Or
I tend to agree with that. That once there is a the vacuum which was there in the executive setup, once that gets resolved, then judiciary will concentrate on their areas.